This is Nightly Business Report with Sue Herrera and Bill Griffin.
Record close, the S&P, the Nasdaq, and the small cap Russell 2000 hit new highs after the U.S. and Mexico reach an agreement on trade.
Staying public, Tesla's flirtation with going private ends, but questions surrounding the company remain.
Hollywood's hot summer. Studios are stepping up their game, and there's one in particular that's behind a number of box office blockbusters. Those stories and more tonight on Nightly Business Report for Monday, August 27th. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. I'm Tyler Matheson, in tonight for Bill Griffith.
Nice to have you here,
Nice to be back.
Welcome back home. I'm Sue Herrera. Good evening, everybody. Well, the last days of summer are anything but lazy on Wall Street. The Nasdaq powered past 8,000 for the first time ever. The S&P 500 closed at an all-time high, and the Dow blew past 26,000. A breakthrough trade deal with Mexico removed a source of uncertainty that's been hanging over these markets for months. So let's get right to the numbers. The Dow Jones Industrial Average rose 259 points. The Nasdaq hit a record, advancing 71 points, and the S&P 500 added 22. Bob Pisani has more on today's market rally.
It was a record-setting Monday for the stock market, with the S&P 500 and the Nasdaq soaring to new highs. The Nasdaq broke above 8,000 for the first time in history, fueled by what else? The FANG names: Facebook, Apple, Amazon, Netflix, and Google parent Alphabet. But trade talks were really the story of the day, and President Donald Trump's deal announcement with Mexico set the stage for stocks to rip higher, and rip higher right across the board. Now, the Dow didn't quite notch a new high of its own, but it did break back above the 26,000 mark for the first time since February, led by Boeing, Goldman Sachs, and Caterpillar. Now, it's no surprise that industrials and materials were among the sector winners today. That happens when trade talk gets optimistic. It also happens with metals and mining stocks. They were up as well. Dollar weakened as well. That happens, too. When you get technology stocks, though, industrials and financials all moving 1% or more, the point is you've got a very powerful rally on your hands. And the overall rally is broadening out. That's the key. It's not just tech names. It's not just FANG names that are moving. Banks and industrials have been moving up as well. We've got a very potent stew of optimism. First, on trade talk. Secondly, strong earnings that are not dropping in the third and fourth quarter. And finally, the strength of the U.S. economy. All three averages now are set to post their best August gains in 4 years. Though trading volume, of course, remains light. It is August, after all. For Nightly Business Report, I'm Bob Pisani at the New York Stock Exchange.
Well, investors are hoping today's trade deal is the first of more to come, but getting to this point took a lot of work, and the work is far from finished. Kayla Tausche has all the details.
President Trump calling it a deal, Mexico calling it an understanding. Either way, it's significant progress by the two countries to resolve some of the thornier issues that have been plaguing NAFTA talks, like content requirements for autos and new rules for wages for factory workers making those cars. Then a 16-year time frame for the deal, the U.S. backing down from a proposal to walk away after just five, and zero tariffs for agricultural products. Farmers awaiting aid to help offset China woes are optimistic on the prospects. It doesn't undo steel and aluminum tariffs placed on Mexico or Canada. It doesn't outline how disputes should be resolved. And for a new NAFTA, Canada would be needed to work out its issues with the U.S., like steep dairy tariffs. Canada's Foreign Minister Chrystia Freeland will arrive in Washington Tuesday to begin those talks. Today, Mexico said a three-party agreement is ideal, but it's possible the U.S. and Mexico could go it alone.
It's a comprehensive understanding, so we could move forward in that event. That is a possibility. Obviously, that is not our desire.
That would present a legal dilemma. Senior White House officials believe they have the authority to move forward with the bilateral deal. Congressional aides from both sides of the aisle say they don't. And some of the most prominent Republican lawmakers needed to move a trade deal forward call today's news just preliminary and say Canada is needed for any deal. The Trump administration's top trade official, Robert Lighthizer, saying it would notify Congress by the end of the day Friday on what deal had been reached. There are hopes of a vote and an executive signature on that deal by the end of November. For Nightly Business Report, I'm Kayla Tausche in Washington.
Art Hogan joins us now to talk about the importance of these trade deals to the market. He is the chief market strategist at B. Riley FBR. Welcome back, Art. Good to see you.
Hey, Sue. Thanks so much for having me.
You know, basically, one analyst that I was talking to today said, you have to look at it this way, one down, but two to go, meaning Mexico, we probably have an agreement with, but we still have Canada and China looming large over this market.
Yeah, I'd say we actually have three to go. I think that the first exit ramp off of the trade war highway was going to be NAFTA. Any way we slice it, they were the first ones in, and they're so important to us in terms of trade, logistics, supply chain. So it's very important to get back to that negotiation process. I've long held that renegotiating NAFTA or whatever you want to call it in some shape or form was going to be the first move by the administration to get some good news on trade out there. I also think good news on trade is clearly being choreographed around the midterm, so that's fine. I think the second leg of the stool will be with Europe. We haven't gone after their autos yet. We haven't escalated with Europe. And I think not escalating with Europe will be the other piece of good news. China's going to be a longer play. China's much more complicated. And really, they're the worst players in trade, right? So in all of the trade tensions, China is the, you know, the one that dumps steel and aluminum and the one that steals IP. So, you know, really, that's going to be the longer play. But I think any good news on trade and trade policy right now is going to be a market positive, as we very much so saw today.
I think you'd have to say, Art, that today was a bit in the market of a relief rally, that things were getting better, though a lot of this was already telegraphed. If this was a relief rally, is the market vulnerable?
Well, I can tell you this, Tyler. We've gotten very little good news on trade. So since the beginning of the year, we've had two significant sell-offs. One was, you know, in February when we're concerned about higher interest rates and the yield on the 10-year blasting through 3% with that high jobs number. The second has all been about trade. There is a significant reason why it's been 7 months from the last peak in the market to Friday, where we made a new high in the S&P, and that was entirely trade. The headwind that is trade, the concerns over tariffs, the concerns over what bad economic offshoots there would be with a mutually destructive trade war with China, that continues to be the case. So I think the market's going to react to any good news, whether we're negotiating, whether we're getting closer. But yes, we've been telegraphing that things were getting better with Mexico for 2 weeks now. We finally came to an agreement with Mexico. We hope the same process can move forward with Canada at this juncture and get this behind us, you know, in the November timeframe. I think not escalating anymore with the Eurozone would be spectacular. And then try to sit down and have concrete conversations with China, but that's going to be a longer play. That's next year's business, I think.
All right. On that note, Art, thank you. Art Hogan with B. Riley FBR.
Well, as we reported last week, some of the country's leading CEOs are concerned that changes to immigration policy will hurt not only their own companies, but the broader economy as well. And as Aditi Roy reports, it could cause skilled workers to leave the U.S.
Shilpa Sachdev has worked in the U.S. since 2013. She moved to the country from India to be with her husband, who was working as an engineer for Microsoft under an H-1B visa. She was able to live in the U.S. under an H-4 visa, designed for spouses of H-1B workers, but there are restrictions. Despite having a college degree and several years of work experience in India, Sachdev wasn't allowed to work in the U.S.
I spent a significant amount of time at home by myself. I was apprehensive to go out and meet people because I would constantly question why wasn't I allowed to contribute to the American economy as well.
In 2015, the Obama administration approved a provision that allowed H-4 workers to be employed in the U.S., and Sachdev started working. She's now a content manager for cloud computing firm ServiceNow. Her husband is an engineering manager at Facebook. The couple owns a home in Los Gatos, California.
For me, being able to work can be summed up in one word. It's independence.
But that financial independence could soon end. The Trump administration has indicated in a recent court filing that it will reverse the Obama-era decision and prohibit H-4 visa holders from working. And companies, many of which depend on foreign labor, are speaking out. In a letter to the administration, top CEOs warn changes to the H-4 work authorization will likely cause high-skilled immigrants to take their skills to competitors outside the U.S.
For us to have policies in place that discourage foreign talent from making the United States their home obviously is going to have a trickle-down effect to companies.
But those who oppose H-1B and H-4 holders working in the U.S. point to cases at Southern California Edison and Disney, which have been accused of displacing U.S. workers with lower-paid foreign employees.
And so it goes on constantly throughout the job market, where these companies are replacing Americans with cheap foreign workers.
Sachdev says the hardest part for her is waiting.
You're at the mercy of what the administration will do. So it's just a wait and watch game from here on out, and it's not fun.
There's a good chance if she's unable to work, both she and her husband would move abroad. For Nightly Business Report, I'm Aditi Roy, San Francisco.
It is time to take a look at some of today's upgrades and downgrades. U.S. Steel was downgraded to underweight from overweight at Morgan Stanley. The analyst cites falling steel prices. The price target is $30. The stock closed right around that level at $30.66. Chipotle's rating was cut to underperform from neutral at Wedbush. The analyst says risk to Chipotle's margins and same-store sales growth has increased. The price target is $4.45. The stock fell more than 4.5% to $4.95.60.
And similarly, American Eagle Outfitters was downgraded to neutral from outperform at Wedbush. The analyst there cites the stock's valuation. Shares have risen about 45% this year. The price target now $29 a share. Shares fell 4.5% to $27.12. Meantime, Papa John's was upgraded to buy from neutral at Kalinowski Research. The analyst says a sale of the company makes sense and that the odds of an acquisition may be increasing. Price target now, $52.50. The stock rose a fraction to 45 and a penny.
Still ahead, tech stocks are hot, but there are some names in that sector that might get even hotter.
Toyota and Uber will reportedly jointly develop driverless vehicles. According to the Wall Street Journal, Toyota will invest $500 million in the autonomous pact. Uber had been looking for ways to lower development costs following a fatal crash involving one of its vehicles earlier this year. The investment now puts Uber's valuation at about $72 billion.
Investors got their first chance today to react to news of Tesla saying it plans to remain a publicly traded firm. But clearly, there is some concern. The shares fell more than 1%. While the decision ends a brief flirtation with going private, it does not mark an end to many legal and business questions swirling around that company. Phil LeBeau has more.
The big corporate story that started with a bang nearly 3 weeks ago has ended with a whimper. Tesla CEO Elon Musk, who created a frenzy by saying he might take his company private at a valuation topping $70 billion, now says Tesla will stay private. Musk explained the decision, saying, "Although the majority of shareholders I spoke to said they would remain with Tesla if we went private, the sentiment in a nutshell was, please don't do this."
I think it's still true that the company should be a private company. That said, is it's just simply not in the cards and sets up what, for what I think is going to be one of the most dramatic stocks over the next few years.
Tesla shares have been on a wild ride since this story started on August 7th. That volatility could continue as investors deal with fallout from Musk's flirtation with privatizing the automaker. The biggest issue? An SEC investigation looking into whether or not Musk misled the market when he tweeted that he had funding secured to take the company private. It turns out there was no deal locked in, and investigators are looking into the basis for Musk's tweets.
I can't say with certainty because I haven't seen all of the evidence and I don't know what the SEC investigation is going to uncover. Maybe there is something out there where he had a reasonable basis. So far, everything that I've seen, each time he speaks, there seems to be an admission as though there was not a reasonable basis.
Overshadowed by all of this is whether Tesla can increase production and sales of its newest electric car, the Model 3.
There's also the question of whether Tesla will be able to turn a profit in the second half of this year, as Elon Musk has promised. If that happens, don't be surprised if this summer saga about Tesla going private quickly fades from the minds of investors who have invested in Tesla and in Elon Musk. Phil LeBeau, Nightly Business Report, Chicago.
Pfizer's experimental heart drug shows promise, and that is where we begin tonight's Market Focus. The company said a study showed that the medication reduced the risk of death in patients with a rare heart disease by 30%. But concerns were raised about competition in the space and whether rival medications were more effective at treating the disease. Shares of Pfizer were off nearly 2% to $41.58. Meanwhile, shares of Alnylam Pharmaceuticals and Ionis, which make competing therapies, saw their shares jump. Well, Netflix is reportedly testing out a system in a number of international markets that lets new users subscribe to the streaming platform outside of the apps run on Apple devices. The move is being made to help reduce the amount of commission fees Netflix pays to Apple to appear in its app store. Netflix shares rose more than 1% to $364.58. And sticking with Apple, sort of, Bloomberg reports that the company will debut three new iPhones, including its largest ever, with a 6.5-inch screen. Apple has yet to announce the date for that. The stock rose a fraction to $217.94.
The software company VMware is buying startup Cloud Health Technologies in an effort to expand and streamline its cloud offerings. VMware did not disclose a price for the deal, but Reuters said VMware is expected to pay about $500 million. Shares of VMware fell a fraction to $150.03. Shares of the chipmaker Advanced Micro Devices rose after investors got a chance to react to a new product announcement over the weekend. The company said it was launching a high-performance graphics card for data centers. Analysts say that new card could result in increased market share. The stock hit a 12-year high, rising more than 5% to $25.26.
Well, with the Nasdaq at a record, should investors look beyond the so-called FANG stocks, Facebook, Amazon, Netflix, and Google, for opportunity? Kim Forrest, portfolio manager at Fort Pitt Capital, joins us right now. Hi, Kim. How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm great. Let's start with the FANGs. Would you touch them at these prices? Or if you don't already own them, should you stay away?
I think you should stay away. I think they've really benefited from, well, great performance of the underlying business, but also for the last couple of years, people have really piled into them and driven up their prices and the price to earnings ratio as well. So, you know, being this sort of value-oriented investor that we are, would look elsewhere as opposed to FANGs.
So you spread the net kind of wide. So not all of tech is overvalued or even fairly valued. You're still finding some good values out there?
We are, and they're kind of in the unloved, or they've made a couple of missteps sort of thing, or maybe in one case that there's a lot of supply of their product out there, but we believe that it's going to shortly turn around.
So let's talk about one of the stocks in the tech space that has been incredibly hot this year, and especially most recently, and that's AMD, the chip maker. This has been a,
right.
This has been a challenge stock for a long time, but it has rocketed up. Is that the one to buy now, or should, as a value player, should I look elsewhere, namely Intel or AMAT?
Well, I would look elsewhere, and that can come as no surprise. I mean, it's done really, really well. If you owned it or own it, congratulations. It's up about 145% this year. Way to go. But looking forward and looking at the history of the company and, you know, their product lines, I'd be wary. It's very, very difficult to keep, you know, executing at a high level. And in the past, AMD has had some disappointments when they've had something similar happen, a good product release, you know, winning market share, and things just seem to happen mm-hmm. to the company. Mm.
Quickly, you also like Intel as well. Why?
Why? Well, because it's kind of unloved at this point. We all know that a couple of years ago, they weren't selling cell phone chips. That seems to not be an issue right now. And AMD is nipping on its heels. AMD came out with a chip using a technology that Intel has missed the mark on. But we believe that because of their prior execution, Intel is going to catch up, and they still have a tremendous amount of market share. But investors do love growth, and that's why AMD is being rewarded right now.
All right, Kim, thank you very much. Great to see you again. Kim Forrest, Fort Pitt Capital.
Well, tonight the nation mourns the death of Senator John McCain, who passed away over the weekend of brain cancer. During his years of service to our country, the senator played a pivotal role in business-related issues. Most recently, he helped block his party's push to repeal the Affordable Care Act. In the 1980s, he became embroiled in the savings and loan scandal. Decades later, in the wake of the financial crisis, he investigated Wall Street wrongdoing, calling Goldman Sachs' behavior, quote, unethical. Senator John McCain, an American hero and an independent thinker who left his mark on the world of business and finance. Walt Disney World employees could see their hourly pay increase to $15 an hour by the year 2021. The proposal is part of an agreement reached between the theme park operator and a group of unions after nearly a year of negotiations. The new deal faces a vote next month by union members. It is expected to be approved.
The entertainment industry is having a sizzling summer as moviegoers flock to theaters. Julia Borsten has more on the box office bounce back.
From superheroes, both animated and live action, to romantic comedies.
So your family is, like, rich?
The summer box office is on fire. The season so far is up 14% over last year, bringing the year-to-date totals up over 9% to the highest ever box office at this point in the year, not adjusted for inflation. Bolstering the box office, Warner Brothers' Crazy Rich Asians, already the top-grossing comedy of the year, with a mere 6% drop between its first and second weekends, nearly unheard of.
That second weekend hold means that this film is going to continue to do well because it's a pure reflection of the enthusiasm that all audiences have for the film.
Though there have been some breakout hits like Crazy Rich Asians, most of the summer's success has been on the back of familiar franchise films, and Disney in particular is cashing in.
What the?
With Incredibles 2, the biggest film of the summer, Disney has a piece of four of the five biggest films of the season, including Fox's Deadpool 2, Solo, A Star Wars Story, and Ant-Man and the Wasp, giving it more than a third of the box office market share year to date. Universal's Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom was the second biggest film of the summer. The question is whether this summer's surge can continue or whether it was a blip in theaters' ongoing competition with Netflix and the like. Investors seem bullish. Year to date, AMC shares are up about 25%, while Cinemark's are up about 9%, and IMAX shares are up some 5%. And fall and holiday films are already drawing buzz, including Marvel's Venom from Sony, Warner Brothers' Aquaman, and Disney's Mary Poppins Returns.
I think we're going to see the potential for a record-breaking year or a near-record-breaking year, given the diverse content that's on the way in the fall and the holiday movie season.
The one factor could hold back the year's totals, Disney doesn't have a Star Wars film to draw moviegoers over the holidays, as it has in the past 3 years. For Nightly Business Report, I'm Julia Borsten in Los Angeles.
The U.S. Open is one of the biggest and most lucrative tennis events of the year. There are reports that the tournament is expected to bring in at least $350 million this year, which is significantly more than, say, the Australian Open. And that may be because of the changes taking place to reinvent that game. Eric Chemmy takes a look at the business of the sport from the National Tennis Center in Queens, New York.
Packed crowds and thousands of fans at the U.S. Open marks the unofficial end of summer as the world's best tennis players gather in New York City for the year's final Grand Slam. 2018 marks the 50th anniversary of the U.S. Open in its current form, when professionals were allowed to compete. And a lot has changed since 1968. As organizers now compete with a 24/7 sports calendar and waning attention spans, they have to keep the excitement year after year. picking up the pace and bringing the energy is key.
The time clock, we're going to have interesting things going on the court. We have, if you come to the Open, we got music, we got all kinds of things going on to make it an exciting event. We don't want you to have to be quiet all the time and mind everything. It needs to be an active, energetic sporting event. And most, even 3 out of 5 set matches don't last any longer than a football game.
Key to this is growing the game. The U.S. Tennis Association has made a big push to getting younger people playing the sport. To attract even more fans, the USTA has remodeled their Orlando headquarters to become more of a destination for tennis lovers, offering low-cost tenniscations.
Most of our camps are 3 or 4 days, okay. And they'll come, they'll play tennis in the morning, they'll have a break, then they'll have more tennis late afternoon, then we have some social activities around it. It's really booming right now. In fact, we just opened last year and our adult camp business is up like 100% from our first year.
To speed up the game, there's a speed clock and a debate over whether the men's matches should be shortened to best of 3 sets. Defending U.S. Open champion Rafael Nadal thinks the current format is best.
I really believe that in the Grand Slam is good to have the best of 5 because that makes long matches and matches that stays there for the history, normally more than the best of 3.
Like it or not, the sports world is changing, and U.S. Open organizers are hoping that the adjustments that they're making will lead to growth of the $6 billion U.S. tennis industry. For Nightly Business Report, I'm Eric Chemie in Queens, New York.
And finally tonight, the most expensive car ever sold at auction fetched $48 million this weekend. As we told you Friday, expectations were high and the results didn't disappoint. The Ferrari 250 GTO was sold by a former Microsoft executive who bought the car in 2000 for what experts say was less than 1/10 of Saturday's sale price.
Wow.
Talk about a 10-bagger.
Return on investment.
Yes.
Wow. It's good to have you back.
Nice to be here.
That'll do it for us tonight. I'm Sue Herrera. Thanks for joining us.
I'm Tyler Matheson. Have a great evening, everybody. We'll see you back here tomorrow night.